Thank you for showing me that. I didn't even know this was possible. So that's a belief. When we believe in the power of our illness over the power of our body to heal, we're going to stay sick. When we believe in the power of our healing over the power of our illness, that's when we're going to heal.
Cue music. Places, everybody, places. We're starting in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Autoimmune Hour, where we look at the rise of autoimmune disorders. I've brought together top experts that range from doctors, specialists, nutritionists, researchers, and even those recovering from autoimmune to bring you the latest, most up-to-date information about autoimmunity and how to live your life uninterrupted.
Thank you for joining us here on the Autoimmune Hour with Sharon Saylor. Always seek sound legal, medical, and or professional advice regarding any problems, conditions, and any of the recommendations you see, hear, or read here on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune and Life Interrupted Radio. And we don't want you to worry about taking too many notes, so you can join the Autoimmune Hour's Courage Club, and we'll send you the transcripts and show notes from every episode. Sign up now at understandingautoimmune.com. Now, back to your host, Sharon Saylor.
Welcome, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Saylor from SharonSaylor.com. And as always, it's my honor and pleasure to be with you here tonight for another brand new episode. And I have an amazing guest. And this is a topic that is not just autoimmune. We're going to talk about it in the realm of autoimmune, but this is a topic that crosses all sorts of boundaries. So I want to introduce you to my dear friend, Elizabeth Kipp. And we're going to talk about her brand new book, The Way Through Chronic Pain, Tools to Reclaim Your Healing Power. And Elizabeth is just an amazing woman. She is a best-selling author, stress and chronic pain management specialist, recovery coach, ancestral clearing practitioner. And I could just go on and on and on. But as you could tell, she just has an amazing understanding of chronic pain, stress management, pain management, all sorts of great things like that. We're even going to talk about healthy mindsets tonight. So welcome, Elizabeth. I want to get you on so we have plenty of time because this is such a huge topic.
Thank you so much, Sharon. It's such a pleasure to be with you and all the listeners and viewers tonight.
Oh, and congratulations on the wild success of your book. I know it's internationally acclaimed now. Bravo.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. It's really how to clear chronic pain non-pharmaceutical methods.
Right.
And ones that I used myself, and they're very powerful, and I just hope the book serves.
Oh, it does. It's awesome. And since you mentioned it, tell us a little bit about your background and your journey from pain to pain-free.
Just a super thumbnail. It's really two components. I was raised in a household where children were seen and not heard. Mm. So we were supposed to hold on to all of our emotions and so forth. So that's significant, right? And then the other piece was I had an accident when I was 14. I fell off a horse and landed on a rock and split my fifth lumbar, and it slipped forward on my spine into my pelvis and dragged the nerve roots with it. And now it's sitting 80% forward on my spine. I had 3 surgeries and a corrective surgery just to stabilize that. And as a result of the surgery, I was prescribed opiates and benzodiazepines as the solution to my pain problem. You know, they tried to do the best they could to keep my quality of life as high as they could. That's all they knew. Until I, 32 years later, right, I really had it. I just was like, this can't be it. I have to get off these drugs. They're going to kill me. And I found a pain management program, this Dr. Peter, who I talked about in my book, who has since passed, but his methods were very powerful. And first of all, we found out that the opiates were causing my pain.
Isn't that fascinating? I've heard that before where not even just opiates, but people say, you know, I got off some of the over-the-counter painkillers and found out that's what was making it painful or making me sick or other things. I find that so fascinating.
Yeah, it's a condition that has a name, hyperalgesia. You can all look it up. And then the other thing was, initially that cleared my back pain. I also had all this gut pain. I had leaky gut. Maybe your viewers are familiar with that. It's a Sims syndrome.
Yeah, we've discussed it on the show, all about the health of our microbiome too.
Sure. So I had a lot of pain there too. A lot of that was emotional. So of course, leaky gut doesn't help either. We cleared that later. It took about a year to clear that after I got out of treatment. But I went into this pain management program with 40 years of back pain and 59 years of gut pain. And I walked out 52 days later with no pain at all. So that's a testament. Got off the medication. We used this thing called Ancestral Clearing, which I'd love to bring in on another show if we could, but I don't have time for that now. Ancestral Clearing, very powerful practice. We brought in a Qigong energy healing, and we brought in adversity. It's kind of like, called it adversity therapy, but it was kind of like once a week we all sat together and each one of us one at a time shared something that happened to us from our childhood that was still unresolved, that we were still carrying. And the whole group supported us and helped us rewrite that story in the present day.
Wow, what a nice thought. Yeah.
It was very powerful. So we were able to change the context of that story into a more empowering story instead of a victim-y story. So that was really powerful. And then, of course, he brought in meditation. Now, I was a 40-year meditator anyway, but on meditation just isn't as powerful. I've been without medication now for 6 years and 3 months, and I feel like I've never been healthier.
Well, bravo. Congratulations. And, you know, what's so exciting to me is we've had these stories of, gosh, that was a long time to be going through that journey. And you came out the other side and you're sharing that Thriver story with us today. So bravo, Elizabeth. Some of the things that you learned, let's go into some of the things that you learned about stress and how we carry that and how that plays into pain.
Well, I'll take you right into the real core, I feel, of my book. And Dr. Peter Prescott was the pain management specialist that ran this program I was in. He shed light on it, and I'll share this with the viewers. It's a hard truth. But I remember the first day I sat in his pain track, I was in the room with 20 other people just like me. They called us hickory nut cases because the doctors just couldn't crack our cases, right? So it was up to Peter to deal with them, right? So I'm sitting there fresh out of a hospital bed because I had detoxed and I was finally in the room with the other patients. And he says, don't judge the moment. And I'm like, just to, so you know where I was as a chronic pain patient in that moment, I said silently to myself, dude, I'm just sitting here minding my own business, trying to survive in this room. I'm not judging anything, right? So you can see the attitude I brought to the game, right?
Yeah. Oh my goodness. A hard nut to crack.
Right off the bat, man. Armored up, right? But I knew I have a science background, and this guy was a researcher, so I knew he had something to talk about, and I just sat there and listened. And I realized within about 30 seconds that he was talking about my pain. That I had been judging my pain my whole life as this bad thing. And I'm like, whoa, right? That's amazing. So it's always been an adversary. It's always been something to fight. And that was the culture that I grew up in. Anytime, you know, I got a cut or a friend, you know, cried or got hurt in any way, the adults would rush in and, you know, try and fix it as soon as possible. So pain became this thing that was bad. I mean, it's not like I was even conscious of it. I'm just telling you what it was. Then he says, which was really a kicker, what are you doing to contribute to your pain? And again, I'm like, what are you talking about? The pain's got me. I don't have it. It's not like that, right? That's just my defenses. It's okay. It gives you an example of an idea of how heavily victimized I was by this experience and how I wasn't owning my power. Right? My power. So he helped us see the power of how our judgment and our behavior fed our pain. And I'll take you through a really quick little example of that.
Awesome. So do we need a piece of paper or anything? What do we need?
I don't think you need a piece of paper, but I think you'll understand it's kind of like this little cycle that we go through. I call it a negative feeding cycle. Feeds our pain. We begin, we have pain, we have a pain event. And we feel isolated from other people because it's ours. We can't share that, right? No one else We can say, ouch, but that's about it. So we get isolated.
I also get into that place there with that, though, of two things. They just won't understand, and or I don't want to burden them.
Exactly. So we begin, we have that event, we get isolated, and in that isolation, we get disconnected. We get disconnected from our friends. We get disconnected from ourselves. We get disconnected from our source, our higher power energy. This huge disconnection. Then we judge the moment as bad.
Hand up on that one.
Right? And then we get attached to this thing, right? We get in relationship with this pain we're having. Then we try and control it. And when we can't control it, because we can't, we get a resentment. And then the whole cycle starts all over again with isolation, more disconnection, more judgment. Oh, it's so horrible. How could this be? More attachment. I got to be able to control this somehow, right? And then more resentment. And it's this negative feeding loop that we get in. And that's something that we're doing that feeds our pain. So the lesson here for me was stop judging the moment. Mm. You know, the body's trying to heal. I broke my arm in seven places up by the wrist a couple years ago. And I managed to get through that whole thing without taking any pain medication. A little bit of Tylenol, but that was it. And I used the tools that I wrote about in the book. I used the tools, which was don't judge and just accept the sensation the body's trying to heal.
Let's go through this a little deeper though, because in my mind, I just got some intuitive hits of like, yeah, but Elizabeth, you just don't get it. It hurts so bad.
Right. Mm-hmm. I understand.
And then telling me not to judge, it's like, what do I do instead?
So imagine, I love the question. The answer to the question is don't do anything. Stop doing.
Not even distracting myself with a stream of good movie.
I'm not saying don't do that because I think that's helpful. And I think it's a lot more powerful for us to be able to sit quietly and accept what we're feeling in the body. Not fight with it. Not say, oh, it hurts so bad, because that, you know, that's resistance. You could, that reaction is a contraction. That's a fighting with. It's not meeting ourselves where we are. It's fighting with what's happening with us. And the idea here is the body's trying to heal. Can I just settle down? Can I just cool down? Can I just calm down and let the body do what it does? It's hurting because it's trying to repair. It's sending us a message, you know, Elizabeth, don't go out and use your arm right now, because we're in lockdown mode trying to heal it. And we need you to rest. We need you to rest right now so that we can bring in, that the body can bring the forces into bear to heal this thing. So I spent a lot of time in meditation when I was healing that. I didn't watch any TV. I just spent time in meditation. And I'm not saying that it's easy, but it is simple to really sit and just accept. And what I noticed was, as soon as I came from, oh my God, it hurts so much, because it did, to I accept this moment where it is, that energy that I was feeling in my arm went from this incredibly intense experience to just energy moving. And it didn't hurt anymore. It didn't actually hurt. It was just a lot of energy. And then that's a very powerful place to be. That's why I'm saying, like, yes, watching TV and then that kind of a distraction, I can understand that. It's not the most powerful choice, is all I'm saying.
Yes, I can understand that now. And for those of the listeners who maybe are not too well versed in meditation, give us an idea of, can we do a guided meditation? Would that be of help if we're not versed in it, instead of just sitting there and trying to calm our mind?
That would not be meditation. Trying to calm the mind would be a losing proposition. My experience, and the experience of so many others that I've done group meditations with, that we all have the same experience. It doesn't matter how long we've been doing it, really. we meditate and we just imagine the listener just in this moment. Take your attention and just put it on the breath. Sharon just did a nice, beautiful exhale. Now take a nice, conscious, deep inhale. And then another exhale. And try and make sure that your inhale and your exhale are even so you don't make yourself dizzy. If you get dizzy, then they're not even.
Oh, good point.
You just continue to watch the breath. You just keep your attention on the breath in and out. And that is a meditation. It's called pranayama, the meditation on the breath. Now, here's where it gets tricky. While we're doing this beautiful following the breath meditation, the mind is going to want to come in, make a comment, and steal your attention away. That's what his job is. So
it's doing a good job over here.
Thought's going to come in and go, boo, right? And you might notice it before it drags your attention away, or you might notice, I'm supposed to be meditating, right? And you just bring the attention back. You just bring the attention back to the breath. It's that simple. Now, it doesn't matter how many times the mind steals your attention away. It matters how many times you come back. It just matters that you come back. And every meditation is perfect. And with practice, you'll notice that the mind becomes calmer. Trying to calm the mind, that's really not the game we're playing. We follow the breath and allow the mind to do what it does, and we continue to change where's our attention. And because we bring it back to the breath as a practice, the mind calms down. This is beautiful, beautiful, powerful tool. It's the most powerful tool. It's the first thing that I teach a client in chronic pain. It's the very first thing. All the chronic pain creates all this chaos in the mind, and meditation helps to clear that. It's where the mind, the brain can really heal the changes that chronic pain brings.
That was beautiful too, because unbeknownst to Elizabeth, guys, I had picked up my grandchild yesterday and tweaked my back a little bit. Not massive pain, nothing like that. But you know, it's a little, okay. Grandchild's getting a little big to pick him up that way. Anyhow, just in those, few minutes, I don't know how many minutes I was breathing there and concentrating on hearing Elizabeth's voice and coming back to the breath, I noticed that little tweak has all but disappeared. And that is amazing. Absolutely amazing. We need to take a quick commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to find out more about Elizabeth and managing our chronic pain, actually eliminating our chronic pain. How about that? And talking about other ways that we can enhance our life. So everyone, keep breathing, keep meditating, keep coming back to the breath, and we'll see you back in just a minute or two.
Life Interrupted Radio will return after these messages from our sponsors. It's great sponsors like these that keep this show coming to you every week. Be sure and stop by lifeinterruptedradio.com to learn more.
Your conscious lifestyle on steroids. OMTimes Radio. IOM FM.
Hello, I'm Lisa Berry. Join me every Monday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time for Light on Living. A chance to see new, hear different, and feel more as I shine the spotlight on all the ways to lighten the load of life's challenges. Light on Living is your link to that new way you're looking for, that new understanding that will enhance your life, and that positive connection that will support your growth. So join me, and you'll gain insight and start to see things in a new way that motivates you.
OM Times Magazine is one of the leading online content providers of positivity, wellness, and personal empowerment. A philanthropic organization, their net proceeds are funneled to support worldwide charity initiatives via Humanity Healing International. Through their commitment to creating community and providing conscious content, they aspire to uplift humanity on a global scale. OM Times. Co-creating a more conscious lifestyle.
Listen and imagine. It takes 5 seconds to send a text, and for those 5 seconds, you're driving blind.
Life is worth more than a text.
stay alive. Don't text and drive.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, Noise, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Sharon, and of course you know me from here on the Autoimmune Hour. Maybe you don't know I'm also an author. My latest book is for kids. It's Pinky Chenille and the Rainbow Hunters, a winner of a 5-star reader's favorite review. It's perfect for your early reader and a great bedtime story for your young adventurers. Check it out over at pinkychenille.com. That's PinkyChenille.com. See you there. Welcome back, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Saylor from SharonSaylor.com, and tonight we're here with Elizabeth Kipp. She's a best-selling author, stress and chronic pain management specialist, recovery coach, ancestral clearing practitioner. I could just go on and on. She today, it's her mission to spread the word that we can heal from chronic pain. It's not a life sentence. And she has a great new book out. It's internationally selling now, just amazing new book, called The Way Through Chronic Pain, Tools to Reclaim Your Healing Power. And Elizabeth was sharing with us the breathing technique to help us release pain and not to judge. I love that. I can use that not just in pain in my life. I can use that too. So Elizabeth, one of the things is we've been here thinking about my breathing during that commercial break and everything. And my back is feeling great right now. It's awesome. Share with me, where does the healing power really lie within us? Or maybe it's not within us.
Love that question. Yeah. So we said earlier that when we feel pain, adults rush to try and fix it, right? And in my experience and the experience of thousands of the chronic pain patients that I've sat in front of, they're looking out there to the doctor, to the medical community. And I flip that. So I take 20% of the responsibility for my healing and I give it to the entire healthcare community. The other 80% is between me and God. That's the way I see it. And I'll tell you why I say that. Doctors can set a bone and stitch up a wound. They can help us set the conditions to heal, but they cannot tell the body how to heal. The power to heal lives inside of us. And this was something that I got really confused about when I was sick, because I was so used to going to the doctor. The doctor has the answer, and the doctor has some of the answers, but the real power lives within.
That's beautiful. And what came to my mind was so powerful. It's the idea of, I have said, and I'm thinking that I was probably programming this into me, because I say a lot of times, I just love this beautiful healing machine. However, that's only talking about the physical healing machine. I'm leaving out some very important parts of me and source and healing, aren't I?
So I love that you brought that in. And here is what I would say about that. I actually had doctors say to me, you will be in level 7 out of 10 pain for the rest of your life, 24/7.
Yeah, great indoctrination. Thanks a lot.
So that was a pronouncement. They had forgotten their basic science. Science works in probabilities. It's probable that. But he didn't say that. He said, you will. So where's the room for hope in there? And really, you've forgotten basic science, which is this. Science lives in a self-limiting framework. It deals with things it can measure and describe. Where do we live? We live in the all that is. We live in the science framework and in the all that is. Where does healing happen? Healing happens in the scientific framework and in the all that is. So it's really important when we're, and I'm not dissing doctors. This is not about that. This is just understanding what they bring to the table and where the rest of healing is going on. It's this, we can't really separate. It's this one big holistic field of consciousness, by whatever you want to call it. We're operating in that. The healing field is in that. And it's in the present moment. It's not in the past or the future. It's right here, right now. That's what I was saying.
I like that you say the present moment, because I'm thinking here, it's not dissing doctors either. It's just what my experience is, this idea of, you know, take two in the morning, you'll be fine. That's in the future. Even though we could say, oh, sure, it's just next morning. But you get the idea, guys, that, you know, here, take this and take enough of this. And in the future, you'll have this change. That doesn't allow for us to have faith and hope that this is really going to recover, because it's always out there in the future.
And I absolutely. And their perspective is that they're also judging the moment as bad. So when have you ever sat across from a doctor who said, except Dr. Peter, when I sat across from him and he said this, when have you ever sat across from a doctor and he said, can you accept how you feel in this moment? This is not what they do. But that's the thing. That's the key that we're missing. The fact that we're railing against our condition. I don't want it to be this way. And I've judged it. And I'm righteous in my stance about, I don't like this and all that. That's just adding to the whole mix of pain and frustration. If we could just get to a point where I accept this, now that would be much better. Now, I'm not saying that I broke my arm and I went to a doctor and he said it. And I went back in a couple of weeks and they checked the cast and it hurt. And they asked me how it was. And I said, it hurt. But they didn't say anything about, can you just accept the present? They never said that. They never said anything about accepting the present moment, because that's not their training. But my experience is this is where the healing field truly lives, in the present moment. And if we can just open and be present to ourselves and our experience, we heal very fast.
And that is so fascinating to me. And I'm bringing in some ideas from and thoughts that I have from other guests. And one of them is not so much, we'll say maybe the wrist, you know, broke the arm type of thing, started the cycle. But have you found people that have pain that keep it going for a variety of reasons? Sometimes it's called secondary gain or whatever. Now I don't have to vacuum because my arm is always, in air quotes, there, not the way it should be.
Well, my experience with chronic pain, people in chronic pain, and this happened to me too, is that we've had it for so long. And I told you, we get this attachment thing and it becomes our identity. So when somebody comes to us with an option like Dr. Peter came to me, or maybe a meditation teacher would bring in the same thing, right? Or somebody like me, who's a stress management coach, comes in with another option and say, you know, you don't have to have this pain. It's optional. The first thing that I would do as a chronic pain patient is say, I'm going to call bullshit on that.
That's a nicer word than what went through my head. We'll use that word.
Yeah. Right? There's all this resistance. We're gonna protect, because it's our identity. Remember, if we're going to protect, it's our identity. It's what we know. And God help us if we try something new and it gets worse. Understand?
Oh, absolutely. I've been there where I'm like, okay, you know what? This is not great, but the status quo is not what it was. So I'm cool. I've been there. I've had to fight my way through that, where my brain's going, hey, you know, this isn't great, but it's not that.
Right. So we've done a couple things there. First of all, we're out of the present moment because we're projecting into the future. Oh, it could be worse. What if it was this? Or we're going back and comparing the past to the present moment, but we're not really just staying here. It's really important that we just accept ourselves where we are. It's not only that we judge the moment as bad, we judge ourselves as bad. And we have this, we worry about what's going to happen next. So there's a lot of fear there. So, and I was just talking about somebody, this is somebody today, we become Olympic level control freaks. And we want to control the playing field, the players, and we want to control the rules of the game. And when we try and control everything in sight and we can't do that, and you know, something happens and like it doesn't work out for us because that doesn't work, we get a resentment, right? And then it starts building again, that cycle of suffering. And where's the room for higher power, source energy to come in and help, because we've set the conditions and we've said this is the way it is. So we've locked all that beautiful universal energy straight out in this mind game that we're playing about control. So when we learn to surrender to our present moment experience, grace comes right in, because it's always there waiting for us in the wings, just if we can just allow it in. Does that make sense?
Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, I love that. We're going to have to make that a tweetable, guys. And we need to take our last quick commercial break here. And when we come back, we're going to talk about another area of this, is where my thoughts want to know more about this idea of when we make it our identity, and as we work to clear that's not our identity, we're here in the moment. What happens with family members, because maybe we've had it a long time as our identity, still identify us that way? So we'll talk to Elizabeth about, okay, so we've decided to change, listen to Elizabeth here, but what happens about friends and family members who still see us the other way? What can we do? So we'll be right back.
Your conscious lifestyle on steroids. OM Times Radio. IOM FM.
Change and growth are part of natural life, and also part of your spiritual life. Everyone needs support and guidance, especially during life passages. Upgrade yourself with the OM Times Experts program. With OM Times Experts, you have access to the best intuitive coaches, spiritual teachers, counselors, astrologists, and oracles. Our team was carefully selected so you can trust. Find out more at experts.omtimes.com.
Grab a cup of tea or a glass of wine and tune in for Inspired Conversations with publisher Linda Joy on Tuesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern. Linda creates sacred space for leading female luminaries, empowering authors, heart-centered female entrepreneurs, coaches, and healers. A soulful venue where guests openly share the fears and obstacles they've overcome, wisdom and lessons learned, and the personal journey that led them to the transformational work they do in the world. Inspired Conversations, to empower you on your path to authentic, soulful living.
Research shows we apologize up to 10 times a day, and most of the time, we say sorry as a response to someone else's mistake. What if we thanked people instead of all that unnecessary apologizing? So instead of saying, "Sorry, I'm rambling," you say, "Thank you for listening." Join us at ProjectForgive.com, a free, non-religious resource on global forgiveness.
Hi, this is Sharon, and of course you know me from here on the Autoimmune Hour. Maybe you don't know I'm also an author. My latest book is for kids. It's Pinky Chenille and the Rainbow Hunters, a winner of a 5-star reader's favorite review. It's perfect for your early reader and a great bedtime story for your young adventurers. Check it out over at pinkychenille.com. That's PinkyChenille.com. See you there. Welcome back, everyone, to the Autoimmune Hour. I'm Sharon Saylor, and I'm here with Elizabeth Kipp, and she is an amazing internationally bestselling author of her new book. I got to get the title right here. The Way Through Chronic Pain: Tools to Reclaim Your Healing Power. She's a stress and chronic pain management specialist, recovery coach, ancestral clearing practitioner, and I could go on and on and on. She's just amazing. And she's been sharing with us her own journey through chronic pain to the other side of amazing success and a pain-free life. We were talking about multiple things, about not judging, being in the present moment, not past or future projections. You mentioned in the last segment about sometimes pain can become at least part of our identity. Now, what happens with we read your book, we go through the process, and we become much better, the pain goes away, that kind of thing. What happens when family members who maybe have taken, quote unquote, care of us for so long, and they still identify with us as the pain? Mm. What can we do to show them that I'm strong? That's not me.
I love that. I love that question. First of all, I would say We need to realize that we are not our pain. We experience pain in this physical body, but we are not our pain. So that's the distinction. And I actually had the experience of my family members not knowing what the heck to do with me. Once I cleared my chronic pain, they're like, what happened?
Not waiting for it to come back and all sorts of things.
It became an interesting exercise for the whole family. If you can imagine one person, there's a dynamic in a family, and we get used to a certain way of being. And then one person in the family dynamic changes, the whole family dynamic changes. So that's important to understand that, just as a compassionate understanding, to kind of give everybody a break, that they have to kind of catch up to what's going on. So I would say be compassionate and patient. And I would encourage you to hold your boundary in as graceful a way as possible. What happened to me was my family members were so used to, you know, taking care of me in a way that I didn't need to be taken care of anymore, that it was this habit. And it was just a habit, right? It was just a habit, and they had to unlearn their habit, just like I had to unlearn the habits that I was bringing to my pain, right? I just had to unlearn all that stuff. It was interesting because I had worked so hard to, you know, handle my own habits and retrain my brain, that when my family members came in and they're trying to help and I don't need help anymore, and I asked them once, and then I would say it again, and then I would say it again. By the third time, I'm like, wow, I'm not being seen, I'm not being heard. So I took it personally. It's not about that, right? It's not about me taking it personally. It's about they have to go through their own retraining process. And we all have to be compassionate and patient with each other.
Oh, that's beautiful. I love that. Now, as you encouraged people, can you just give me, from your own personal experience, and I know you've worked with hundreds and thousands of people in chronic pain, about this boundary setting, as far as, I think sometimes people struggle with boundary setting, and I know that to not fall back into the trap of, oh, it's just easier. What are some tips and clues that you can give people on how to elegantly or graciously set a boundary or two that, hey, this is the new normal is now?
Well, no, thank you, as a beginning. I appreciate that you're trying to help me, and that's your way of loving me. And I really appreciate that, and I see that. And I don't actually need that anymore.
Oh, what a positive affirmation for yourself as well. I don't need that anymore. Not only are you giving affirming things to the other people, but just laid upon yourself a positive affirmation that's not you. That's not you. That's beautiful. We're down to just the last 13 minutes, Elizabeth. Time flies. I want to make sure that we get in any more of your amazing thoughts and understandings about this topic. What else would you like to share with us that I haven't had the insight to ask right yet?
I would like everyone to remember one thing. If they only remembered one thing from this experience that we've had, that you've allowed us to have, is this. I am my greatest healer. That's the mantra I want you to come away with. I am my greatest healer.
I am my greatest healer. And if you're not watching it on video, she has both her hands over her heart chakra area. And I love that. And just so people know, I loved it because she was leaning forward into the camera too. It was very firm. You were very committed to that statement.
It's really important. It's fundamental. I think it's really important that we understand where the power to heal lives.
Oh, amazing. Amazing. Now, one of the things that you do talk about a little bit in the book is coming through past traumas. We've talked about that on the show before. And as you went through this whole process of learning not to judge, being in the present moment and things, did you find that every so often unexpected things popped up and you're like, where'd that come from?
Yes. Yes. No, it still does. And that's life. The interesting thing about trauma and my experience with that, not just with me, but with the clients that I work with and other people, is it seems to come off in layers. Now, I've had experiences where a piece of it will drop all at once and it's done. And I've had, but most of my experiences are it comes off a layer at a time. And it seems like, again, the body's the greatest healer. It knows how much to release at once. It doesn't overflood our psyche. It may feel like, oh my God, this is a lot. It's not any more than we can handle. And it's really kind of a beautifully measured response that the body knows. It has this beautiful wisdom. Where we get in trouble is when we judge. Oh, here it is again. Oh, I thought I got over that. Is this, you know, am I not healing fast enough? All that kind of stuff. When we bring all that in, we put a cloud over all the sun that just is trying to shine.
And as you said that, my metaphor I'm thinking is probably I got to come up with a new metaphor, because I've always said it's another layer of a stinky onion. And yet, I'm seeing and hearing from you right now that metaphor is probably not beneficial at all. Kind of labels and judges exactly the thoughts that are going through my brain at that moment.
I mean, everybody does it. I'm still, you know, I still have, oh, I just, look how you just judged that. And, you know, I can feel it in the body when something happens and I get judgmental. I feel it as tension and contraction in my body. And I'm like, oh, there you doing it again. It took a long time to program all that. It's going to take a little while to retrain the brain.
One of the things I love to say about retraining the brain is, you know, you're making progress when the time between you notice it and the time you're able to clear it gets shorter. And even actually the time you notice it, sometimes you might be stretching your back or whatever, and it takes you a while to notice, oh, something's not quite right. So as long as that time is getting shorter between noticing and correction, you're making progress, okay? That's how I look at that. I like to just keep making progress. Keep optimizing is our word here, Elizabeth, on the Autoimmune Hour. It's not about healing, not about cure. It's about optimizing ourselves every day. And I love this idea of not judging and how we can put that in other areas of our life, not just chronic pain. How often do we judge things that make us tight? Or I'm thinking, I was driving in very heavy traffic this morning, and gosh, I was judging several other drivers quite with regularity. And I realized when I got out of the car, I'd created my own stress. I just felt like this bundle of stress when I got out of the car. And that's not really related to the chronic pain, but not being in the moment.
Oh, yes, it is. That'll bring it on. It'll just feed it. You know, we talk about, autoimmune diseases, as it's quite complex, as you know. And it's got all kinds of layers to it. And it's a chronic pain phenomenon. And so, you know, my value to this program really is in helping the person that's dealing with chronic pain, or people that take care of them, or somebody's in recovery from it, to help them understand what is their role, what is it that they're adding into their chronic pain experience, so that they might be able to shift that and reduce the whole situation. You know, just like you did with the breath, when you felt, you know, you finally just kind of dropped into the breath and allowed yourself to just breathe, and the body just took over and just cleared that thing in your back.
Wow. Can you give us a couple examples of clients that you've worked with that maybe it was a real surprise to you, that you were like, wow, I didn't see that one coming?
Oh, well, I did work with a woman I talk about in my book, this is kind of in the introduction. Her name was Claire, and this is pretty typical of what I see. She'd been to every kind of doctor she could find, and she tried everything, and nothing seemed to work, and people kind of are at their wits' end. And so we did a couple things. One is I listened to her story. And usually, what's interesting is it's rare that somebody with chronic pain can sit across from a chronic pain, somebody else who knows chronic pain so well from experience, and tell their story so that the other person really gets it. So that's very powerful. Just being able, a chronic pain patient talking to another chronic pain patient about their experience, huge. And the other piece that we did right away with her was ancestral clearing. So it's a beautiful process that helps us clear old patterns, whether it's in the past, in the immediate past, in the past, in this lifetime, or even in the lineage. And so we did an ancestor, that's a whole process, which I have to have another show about. We did an ancestor clearing with her. And so the whole process was like, that was maybe a 35, 40 minute session with her. And she felt better. And she was so surprised. And she said, wow, I feel better. I didn't even know this was possible. That was what she said.
Wow, what a belief.
Thank you for showing me that. That's right. I didn't even know this was possible. So that's a belief. When we believe in the power of our illness over the power of our body to heal, we're going to stay sick. When we believe in the power of our healing over the power of our illness, that's when we're going to heal. That's just my experience. That's how strong belief is. And anybody can go and look up Bruce Lipton's work around the biology of belief. And he lays it out really beautifully.
Wow, that's amazing to me. But I'm just thinking how often we hear that once we get stuck in that cycle.
She also had hung on to her identity. And what was beautiful about this client was that she was able to put aside her hanging on to this, her identity as a chronic pain patient. She saw there was another possibility. And I just have to take my hat off to everybody that's in recovery from chronic pain, because it takes courage to drop your identity. Imagine the courage it takes to drop your identity and try on a new one, especially when you've been hurting for so long, you have no idea what's going to happen in your new, in this new thing.
And my mind popped forward when you said that, trying to stay in the present, guys, but my mind popped forward. It's like, wow, how would I know even what identity I want? I mean, trying to be present with it will come, except as it unfolds.
That's right.
And yet my mind, even though Elizabeth just taught us that to us moments ago, my mind automatically popped forward into, huh, how would I know what identity I want?
Well, it's important that we're able to do past and future stuff, because it helps keep us safe. We have these behaviors because it, you know, everybody that came before us had these because it keeps us safe in our environment. So we have to have compassion with this behavior, but we also have to put it in its place and understand when it's applicable and when it isn't.
Oh, wow. Wow. We're just down to the last 5 minutes, Elizabeth. Tell us anything more you'd like us to know, and where can we get your book and work with you? So tell us a little bit about all of that good stuff.
So I have a website, elizabeth-kipp.com. That's Elizabeth. You have to put the dash in. Last name, Kipp, K-I-P-P, like Peter Pan.com. You can find my book on Amazon, and you can find my book on my website. If you want an autographed copy, you can just click on the little icon on my, there's a little ad there for my book, and you can just click on there, and you can just follow the yellow brick road there to my book. It'll take you to a link and everything. And I just would encourage everyone to really understand where the responsibility lies in their healing. And again, understand the power to heal is within us, and it's important that we own our stuff around our healing.
That's beautiful. It's important that we own our stuff. Always that duality of the mind going, yes, and that's what happened to me right there, everyone. This is Elizabeth Kipp. Thank you so much, Elizabeth. We're both members of Wellness Universe, and that's how we met. And I always love finding great guests this way. So if you've got an idea for a great guest like Elizabeth, please drop over to understandingautoimmune.com, and there's a little button there that says be a guest and give me an introduction, because it's awesome. The people that I meet on this journey of my life, it's always fascinating. Thank you so much, Elizabeth, for sharing your wisdom. Everyone, go get her amazing new book. I just love it, and it's an international bestseller now, called The Way Through Chronic Pain, Tools to Reclaim Your Healing Power. And it's Elizabeth, dash or hyphen, however you want to say that, K-I-P-P, two P's at the end there, .com. Have a great week, whatever your adventures. Join me next week for another brand new episode, as well as pop over to Facebook, Instagram, and or Twitter under Understanding Autoimmune and join us there. Keep the conversation going on social media with us. We'd love to see you there on all of our social media. Everyone, enjoy.
Thanks so much, Sharon.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
The information provided on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune and Life Interrupted Radio, including the websites understandingautoimmune.com and lifeinterruptedradio.com, plus social media, is for educational purposes only. What you read, hear, and see on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune and Life Interrupted Radio, and its websites and other media outlets is based on experience only. The information should never be used for any legal, diagnostic, or treatment purposes. Always seek sound legal, medical, and or professional advice regarding any problems, conditions, and any of the recommendations you see, hear, or read here on the Autoimmune Hour, Understanding Autoimmune, and Life Interrupted Radio.
Research shows we apologize up to 10 times a day, and most of the time, we say sorry as a response to someone else's mistake. What if we thanked people instead of all that unnecessary apologizing? So instead of saying, "Sorry, I'm rambling," you say, "Thank you for listening." Join us at projectforgive.com, a free non-religious resource on global forgiveness.
Do you want to be a better leader, have better relationships, become more self-aware, be a better communicator? Hi, I'm Sharon Saylor, best-selling author, professional speaker, and executive coach. And my life passion is empowering professionals to be the best that they can be. After years of working with professionals, I've discovered the 7 things nobody is telling you that can cost you your clients, sales, and even your career. And I want to give it to you free. You've heard my show, you know my passion, and maybe we'll be working together sooner rather than later. So go grab this ebook now to find out the 7 things that's costing you big time over at SharonSaylor.com/radio gift. Take a moment now to go to your favorite spot. That's right, you know the spot. Take a look around and notice all the colors, the patterns, the textures. As you get comfortable here in your favorite spot, noticing all the nooks and crannies, shake it out, wiggle it out, relaxing all those nooks and crannies in your body here, right now in your favorite spot. Take a moment to savor the temperature, your favorite temperature. Take a moment to savor the smells. That's right. Take a nice deep inhale and relaxing exhale to cleanse out any little remaining discomfort. Let it go now. Noticing the feeling of safety you have here in your spot, your favorite spot. Taking a nice deep inhale, savoring the exhale in the feeling of safety here in your spot. Now take a moment and ask those parts of you, is there anything they'd like to share here in this moment of safety, this place of safety? That's right. Any little thought that passes through, thank it for coming. Without judgment or label, thank it for coming. And just comment, "Isn't that interesting?" and let it go. That's right. Continue to invite any little part of you to share what it's been wanting to share from this place of safety. No judgments, no labels. Knowing that it's safe here with you, right now, right here in your favorite spot. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? And let it go. thanking each and every part of you that shared just now. With gratitude and appreciation for being willing to bring this up right now, to share with you, to know that you can use your imagination, curiosity, and creativity to work through anything that was brought up or wandered through just now. Ask those parts of you that are in charge of your imagination, creativity, and curiosity to get to work on them right now. That's right. Now that we've charged our imagination, creativity, and curiosity, take a couple of nice deep cleansing breaths, knowing that we can come back to this spot anytime, anywhere, and ask imagination, creativity, and curiosity what it is we need to know next. That's right. Taking all the time you need right now. One more deep cleansing breath, coming back awake, aware, alert, and alive, ready to start your day again. That's right. Letting it go. Welcome back.